pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Upstand, one of the club representatives stand up and say hey and say what you're about. So first club, African American Republican Club of Collin County. Do you have a representative here?
I'll stand up since Jim Stewart, our president, is not here, but African American Club, we started years ago. We would ask for everybody's help and support as we try and build a party to help our party and help our nation by more participation in our conservative values and spread the word about that. We need your help. Thank you very much.
I'm representing the McKinney Tea Party, and we meet the second and fourth Tuesday of every month over in Cottonwood Creek Baptist Church. We have some great speakers. We had a really good win for our club this last week when the city kind of caved on their ETJ land grab out there. We have been celebrating that. We worked very hard against that for that, and they finally backed off on that. So that was a really good win for us. I'd like to see our meetings. Thank you.
Fiscal responsibility, personal responsibility, national sovereignty, and the rule of law. And just a real quick update, everybody knows about the lawsuit, right? The Tea Party lawsuit. We were one of the original 28 groups that sued the IRS, and we won. It was incredibly humbling to get to write my signature down on that piece of paper. That is historic. It's going to go in the National Archives, and it's the first time any government agency has ever pled guilty to what they did to us. Our whole board's a little bit euphoric right now. But it's kind of over, but we'll keep going forward. But you know what? Just goes to show you that just a small group of people can make a huge difference. And that and some really, really good lawyers. So, with that, get on to our program. John Phillips, Susan, you need no introduction. I wasn't going to give a full-minute bio. I'm going to let him tell us about himself.
Can y'all hear me? I hate microphones. Can you hear me in the back? Good. That's why I'm called a big mouth. I'm really honored to be here. This is, I can't begin to tell you what a treat this is for me. And I guess I owe part of why I'm here to Dr. Ben Carson. Let me tell you a little bit of the story. So in May, June of 2013, I was talking to a buddy. We're fed up with the direction the country's going in, and we're trying to figure out what we can do. And we said, well, we'll start a PAC and support some congresspeople. Yeah, everybody's doing that. And then we started talking about history. And the name Barry Goldwater came up. And we said, gee, Goldwater was drafted to run. He didn't want to run. He fought running. Who can we draft to run for president? And we kicked around some names and decided they were more part of the problem than potentially part of the solution. And I said to my buddy, I said, did you happen to see the National Prayer Breakfast on TV? And he said, yeah. I said, remember the black guy that Dr. Carson that gave gave the speech, and he stood right next to Barack Obama, and he said, political correctness sucks, Obamacare sucks, and redistribution of wealth sucks. And now, you all may not know this, a week later, Dr. Ben Carson got audited by the IRS. I'm sure it was a coincidence. And I thought, here's a guy, unlike anyone else in the country, that's got the guts to tell Obama to his face that his policies are dreadful. I said, let's do a little more research into this Carson guy and see what we find. So we read his books, we watched his movie, we did as much checking and vetting as we possibly could, and we came to the conclusion that while he's not a politician, while he's very soft-spoken, he might be a really, really good president of the United States. So we set off to draft Dr. Carson to run. And we began the process by going to a buddy of mine that runs a very large conservative fundraising organization. And we ran the idea by him, and he said, okay, John. He said, I'll put up the front money to send out 50,000 pieces of mail to conservatives around the country. He said, but understand, you will lose money on this mailing, and when the final numbers are in, I'm coming to you for whatever the difference is. Okay. We ended up netting $75,000 from that very first mail. And what that told us was, Dr. Carson resonates with conservatives. Lots of people obviously watch the National Prayer Breakfast because they love this guy. We then went out with we ended up mailing over 30 million pieces of mail for Dr. Carson during the draft committee campaign and also after he decided to run. And that was probably, I was doing a talk kind of like this during the draft movement in Colorado. We had some really, really great supporters in Colorado. And the gentleman who introduced me said, Mr. Souza doesn't know this yet, but the reason he was put on this earth was to do this, was to draft Dr. Ben Carson to run for president. And I thought about that, and I thought, gee, maybe. I thought it was for some other stuff. But that was truly the most incredible experience I've had in my entire life. And I've had lots of experiences, good, bad, and ugly. But that really, really was just incredible for me. While we were doing the draft, now I'll circle back, kind of why we're all here tonight. While we were trying to draft Dr. Carson, it was prior to the 2014 elections. Dr. Carson said in some speech he gave somewhere, he said, well, if the Senate changes hands in the upcoming election, that will tell me that the American people are interested in the change, and that will motivate me to probably run for president. So we thought, okay, so how do we get the Senate to change hands so he runs for president? So we looked at all the Democrats that were up for re-election, and there were two. There was one in North Carolina and one in Louisiana, who we thought might be a little bit vulnerable. So what we did is we spent over $1 million running ads on black radio stations in those two states to let the black community know that they've been lied to by the Democrats, that the Democrats will to their face say, yep, we're for school choice. We want your kids to have the best education. And then they go to Washington and they vote against school choice. That, oh, we don't believe in killing babies. That's just all wrong, right? Uh-huh. They go back to Washington and vote for pro-abortion legislation. And on and on and on. And so we ran these ads on these issues that we knew would resonate in the black community. Y'all remember Bob Feckel, who was on The Five? Okay. So election night that night. Oh, don't you get it? He was great. I love Bob Feckel. He's the only liberal that's been on Fox that I can tolerate. Anyway, election night, he's looking at some sheets of paper and he says, and in North Carolina, the Republican has gotten 18% of the black vote. No, that can't be right. And he throws the paper off to the side. Well, in fact, it was correct. Because of our ads, 18% of black voters came out and voted for the Republican. What we don't know is how many black voters stayed at home because we confused them, right? Well, wait, we've been told this for 40 years, and now you're saying this? Maybe we'll sit this one out. So, we won, not we won, but our ads helped bring out the black vote in both North Carolina and Louisiana. Both those Democrat incumbents lost, and Ben Carson announced his candidacy for president. We did the same thing for Donald Trump. We raised the money and we ran ads in Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. All blue states, right? Republican hasn't carried those in ages. The black vote in all three of those states was double what it had ever been. And Trump carried. Now, I'm not saying we got Trump elected. I'd love to take credit for that. But we helped, and our ads and our message to the black communities really resonated. We had an absolutely, I believe, phenomenal lunch this afternoon. Am I right? And we had 10, 12 black pastors that, fortunately, we were all blessed that they just didn't sit there. They all spoke up. They're all conservatives. they all really care about this country. And what I heard was a high level of frustration by these folks saying, we want to be part of the team, and the Republicans aren't letting us. They don't come and visit our churches. They don't come into our communities. And as a result, our people don't know who they are. So we're not going to vote for them because they've been brainwashed into believing that all Republicans are bad people. And we can't change that unless we get into the communities, we meet with the people, we talk to the folks one-on-one. And it's not going to happen overnight, right? I mean, we were talking about baby steps today. And so for all of you running for office, and God bless you for doing it, I did it when I was 24 years old, and I'll never do it again. Not that it wasn't the best experience of my life, but no, thank you. Too many skeletons in the closet at this point. It's just so important for I get really befuddled when I see ads run by Republicans on Fox News. They're all going to vote for you anyway. Why are you wasting your money running ads on Fox News? I mean, it's just stupid. And yet, year after year after year, we do it. And I don't get it. I don't get the Republican Party, period. I stopped giving them money a long time ago. If I like a candidate, he gets my check. He or she gets my check. But not the party anymore. So coming full circle, after we did the Trump thing, we then renamed our first PAC was Run Ben Run. Right, that was for Dr. Carson. Then we changed it to 2016 committee. That was to help Dr. Carson get elected. And then we recently changed it to the Stars and Stripes Forever Super PAC. And our goal, our mission, is to run radio ads in states where U.S. senators are, Democrat U.S. senators are vulnerable in 2018, trying to get a percentage, and we don't need a big percentage. You all running for office, you don't need a big percentage of the black voters to put you over the top. It's in most states we figure it's 7, 8, 9, 10%. If you can get that percentage of minority voters to vote for the Republican, you win. And that's what we did in the three states in the presidential race in last year. And it doesn't take a lot to get there. But one of the things we talked about today is this is not a short-term goal, right? It's important to win elections in 2018 and then in 2020 and so on and so forth. But this has to be a long-term mission. We don't want to do what the Democrats do, which is go into the minority community 6 months before an election. Hi, I'm going to give you everything you want and vote for me and trust me and I'm wonderful and then ignore the people for the next year and a half or 5.5 years. And then go back and do the same thing. And for some reason, minority communities in this country trust the Democrats, even though that's what they do. Now, they vote for things to stop any kind of welfare reform or to increase Section 8 housing or like Obama did. He put billboards up all over the United States saying, call 1-800-FOODSTAMPS and get more food stamps. Or what was it, the Obama phone or whatever that was. You all know when Lyndon Johnson, his famous quote, right, of 50 years ago, which is repulsive, it's undignified, it's un-American, but it worked. He set up his program and poor people and minorities flocked to the Democrat. The Democrats. Why? Giving stuff away. Stuff we all paid for, by the way. But nevertheless, it worked. So we have a really hard, big job in front of us. And that is to take the credibility away from the Democrats in the minority communities. It can certainly be done. We've now done it 3 times. And as one of the pastors said today, it's more than radio spots. And you're darn right, it's a lot more than radio spots. It's getting into those communities and shaking the hands and getting to meet the people and talking to them honestly. Don't promise stuff you can't deliver. That destroys us right out of the chute. You can't deliver it, don't promise it. And by the way, there is only one reason to do this, one reason that makes it worthwhile to do it, and that is to protect our republic. Because if we don't, folks, we're going to lose it. Chelsea Clinton's going to run for president. I just ruined all your nights. Or Michelle Obama. I'm sorry. That was just over the line. But the point is that if we don't do this, our country's gone. I mean, it truly is, and it will take heaven only knows how many years, decades, to try and get it back, and how many billions of dollars it will take to try and get it back. We don't have to go down that road. All we have to do is reach into the minority communities and say, we give a damn. We really do care. We're brothers. We're brothers and sisters. We may have differences, and because of slavery and racism that was rampant when I was a kid, yeah, they've got issues. We've all got issues. But we need to relate to those issues. We need to understand them and not dismiss them. Yeah, listen, no one alive today was a slave, and no one alive today was a slave owner, so let it go. Doesn't work that way. You can't do that because for a lot of blacks, it's a very emotional thing. It's ingrained in their being. And listen, I'm the first one to say that I don't think a dime of reparations ought to go to a single black person because someone in their family was a slave. But I do think we need to understand who and what the makeup of these folks is, and really listen to them. And when one of the pastors said today, I've been driving black in the Dallas area for however old he is, and I've never been pulled over by a cop. Okay, but a lot of young black kids have been, and therefore they think cops hate me, right? Cops are against me. I'm sure, are there some bad cops? You bet there are. But every cop I've ever met during my lifetime has been a good, God-fearing, country-loving law enforcement officer that treats everybody the same way. You treat him with respect, he, she will treat you with respect. You get pulled over by a cop and you flip them off, yeah, that sets up a whole new scenario, right? So it's impossible for me as a white person to understand what black people are thinking, what they're feeling about their ancestors and about slavery and racism and all of that stuff. But I will bet my last dollar that in this room, there's not a racist. If you were, you wouldn't be here tonight. But over the last year and a half, we've all been labeled racist and deplorable and homophobes and you know, all of the nasty words that Hillary could come up with. And it's unfair, we don't deserve it. But when the Democrats say that about us, there's a percentage of people out there that believe it. Right? Oh, Steve Bannon's a white supremacist. Yes, he is not. He's a conservative that cares about his country. Does he go over the top occasionally? You bet he does. That's okay. We just need to find a way, and it's going to take a bunch of money, and it's going to take time and effort and energy, but more than anything else, it's going to take really caring, working hard, and trying to understand where our brothers and sisters are coming from. If we do that, we can get that 8, 9, 10%, even in 2018, to come over to our camp. I know you've all seen the polls that show somewhere between 35% and 40% of blacks are conservative. They have the same beliefs that we do. What do they want? Excuse me. They want a better life for their kids than the life that they have. I'm guessing most of you in here are parents. And if you want different than that, no, of course not. You want your kids to have a better life than you had. However you define it. Happiness, money, education, jobs, whatever all of that means. That's what the black community wants. They want their kids to have a good education. And that's a real, real challenge. I think I heard someone running for school board. Is that you, sir?
Yes, sir.
You got a Herculean task ahead of you when you get on the school board, because you've just got to stop the nonsense that's going on now. The union schools are just killing us. Kids aren't getting an education. People sit in the state houses and make up rules and laws and regulations that they don't understand, but force onto the teachers and force onto the school districts. Give you a perfect example. In Connecticut, where I'm from, my wife, until she got beat up by a couple of her kids last year, was a special ed teacher. And some genius in Hartford said, well, when we test the kids, we'll include the special ed kids in the scores. Hello? You've got kids that are 19 years old with a third grade mentality, and they're going to take the same test as other 19-year-olds? Come on, give me a break. But some moron in Hartford thought that was a splendid idea. What happened to the Connecticut scores? Down the toilet. And you know, I'm sure there's teachers and former teachers in the room, you know, that could give us just horror stories about this kind of thing. So it's interesting if you look, and I'm going to shut up in a minute and open up to questions and answers, because you probably, I have no idea what you want to hear, and I believe you, I'm a big mouth, I can go on all night. Charter schools. What kids mostly go to charter schools? Minority kids. And in charter schools, go figure, they end up going on to college or vocational training. Their lives improve by huge percentages. Why can't we do that in all schools? Well, we got a lot of teachers with tenure who really don't give a damn. They just want to spend the last 10 years, 15 years of their career and put in time. They care less about the kids. They don't care whether the kids learn anything. They've got their job. It's all wrapped up. So long as they don't molest a kid, they're okay. And even in New York, you molest a kid and you can't teach anymore, but every day you go to a room in New York City and you sit there for 8 hours and the state gives you a check for $100,000 a year. Hello! I mean, stupidity is running rampant. Teachers who are convicted of molesting kids are still getting paid by the taxpayers. Yep. How in any sense of the world is that right? It's not, but it's the teacher union. It's the contracts. So, let me just wrap up by saying thank you for coming tonight. I don't care whether you listen to me or not, but do something, right? Go to the minority churches, go into the minority communities, and talk the truth about what conservatives believe. And while you're not gonna get every black person in the church saying, hey, that's great, amen, I'll vote Republican. Get to, we're on our way. And people talk, right? They talk in the hair salons and the barbershops and the drugstores and they tell each other stories. And when we run our ads, that's the way we do it, is we have two black actors, usually a male and a female, and they have a conversation about the issues. And it really hits home. It's just so good. And we all, I don't care what color you are, what religion you are, what race you are, we all deserve to be treated fairly and honorably and with respect. And we as conservatives, as Republicans, Not that we have mistreated the minorities. I don't think that's true at all. We just kind of ignored them. We got to stop that. We really, really have to stop that. Otherwise, we're going to turn the whole country blue, including the great state of Texas. And we'll stand no chance of turning any others around. I mean, Connecticut is already gone. But by the way, there are no Republicans in Connecticut right now because I'm here. So with that, let me thank you so very much for coming out tonight. This has been a real treat for me, and I'd like to open it up to questions. Give me 1 second, and then. So I think you all know who my great grandfather was, right? John Philip Sousa. Mm-hmm. And so I'm always asked the question, what instrument do you play? Okay, you got the answer. So, I do go around the country, which is a real joy to me, narrating Sousa concerts, mostly with community bands. And I meet some wonderful people and good patriotic Americans. And it's just a real honor. Before I answer your question, can I tell one Sousa story?
Please do.
Okay. So, many of you probably don't know this, but Sousa was Frank Sinatra, the Beatles, Elvis Presley, and Michael Jackson all rolled up into one while he was on this earth. his band was the most popular band in the world. That's not an understatement. It's a real fact. Sousa made a fortune. I don't know what he did with the money. But he made a lot of money. When World War I broke out, John Philip Sousa was 62 years old. And John Philip Sousa, being the patriot that he was, shut down his band and he joined the United States Navy, raising money for the war effort. And he raised millions of dollars. And he said the day he joined the Navy, I hope I can remember this, he said, "I joined the reserves on the last day of May. I gave up my band and $1,000 a day. My $1 a year is my government pay. My God, how the money rolls in." And Sousa, I can tell you Sousa's stories forever, but Sousa so loved the Navy and, of course, the Marines, but he is buried in his Navy uniform in Congressional Cemetery in Washington, D.C. And I'm going to be buried right next to him. Congressional Cemetery is open to dogs. So people can bring their dogs, and the dogs roam around, and I'm a dog lover. And then on Sousa's birthday, the Marine Band comes over and plays a concert. So I'm going to get good music and dogs. That they know that. Okay, so with that, let's open it up to questions. I think the rules are you want to get a microphone so we can get you on tape, so we have proof that you were here. So, sir, you've got right there.
Right here. It's a pleasure to be here to listen to you. I'm from Massachusetts, by the way.
Okay. Welcome to my world.
And I'm glad I came to Texas instead of the South. If we're going to keep Texas red, we have to take a new approach toward the Latino community.
Okay.
Could you give us some thoughts about that? Because I agree with you about the blacks. I think your strategy and your tactics make a lot of sense to me. But I'd like to hear your comments about the Latinos.
Sure. So I think it's exactly the same deal. As candidates, as conservatives, as Republicans, we need to go into their communities. We need to talk to them because they've learned from the black community, right? Republicans bad, Democrats good. And so we need to break that cycle with them. And by the way, they want a better life for their kids. They want their kids to have a better education. They want school choice. Most of them are Christian by nature. They don't like abortion. They agree with us on all the biggies, right? They want a military to protect them. They want job opportunities. They want growth. And by the way, from the polls I've seen, those that are here legally can't stand the illegals.
That's right.
Because it's hurting them.
That's right.
It's difficult not to stereotype, right? You hear someone speaking Spanish next to you, illegal. I've been here for 20 years. Right? And it's not fair, it's not right. But we get pinned with that. So I would simply say, and by the way, I agree with you, especially here in Texas and in Arizona, and forget California. I keep begging my good friends who live in California to move out so I can pray for the earthquake. Watch, it'll happen while I'm there on a business trip. but it's really the same thing, sir. It's getting the communities understanding, you know, what their issues are, though I bet dollars to donuts the issues are exactly the same as they are with all of us and in the black community and in the Asian community. And
there's another challenge, and that is that the blacks speak our language. The Latinos, so many of them, you've got to approach them in their language.
I agree. So
I think that has to be part of the strategy.
Well, it does, but the day will probably come where anyone running for office in this country is going to be bilingual. By the way, I hope that doesn't happen. I would much prefer people that immigrate to this country, just like they did decades ago, right? The first thing they did was learn the English language.
But that takes a couple of generations.
I'm sorry?
I said that takes a couple of generations.
No question. So
I'm an example.
German is primary language.
A lot of them that emigrate here, okay, they understand English, but they cannot speak English, okay? And they're shy about that, all right? The first generation born here, they're the transition generation. We can't wait another generation.
I agree. So we run ads on Spanish radio stations in Spanish, right? And communicate with them. And listen, there are no shortage of translators. So any of you running for office that think you need the Latino vote, take a translator with you when you go someplace and say, sorry folks, I don't know Spanish, but I want to talk to you. And the translator says whatever he says, right? And they will respect the effort. They absolutely will respect the effort to communicate with us. And most that are here legally, I believe truly, now this is not true with everyone that's come to this country, but I believe Latinos truly want to be part of the United States of America.
Oh, yeah, they love it.
Right? So if Republican candidates will go into the communities, again, with a translator, and make a real effort, I'll bet you most of those people will make a real effort to learn more English by the time the next election comes along. Maybe a generational thing, right? And I don't disagree with that. But everybody needs to make little baby steps towards the middle. And I believe the Latino community will do that.
All right, I'm gonna stand up for this, because when I first got into really wanting to join the Republican club, community, it's not a good story. I called a phone number. It was one of the Republican Plano. And the voicemail that I got was, if you speak English, blah, blah, blah. If you speak Spanish, call back when you learn English. And to me, that was a slap in the face. To me, I'm trying to get involved in the Republican Club. So we've got to control our message. And a lot of this is fear. People not wanting to get out of their comfort zone. People are fearful of someone that doesn't look like them. And no, I mean, people would assume that I'm going to be a Democrat because I'm a Hispanic. But when I spoke to that parent, to that person, I had my school call it and ask them, what did you think about that message? Was it inviting? And the answer was no. And I made a big stink about it, but I tell you what, I looked for the conservative clubs in this in Collin County that would accept me. And I tell you, one of the first ones was Golden Quarter. I was very grateful to that club. So I'm telling you, it's the message, and get out of your skin, get out of that fear that you have inside of you, because we are people, everyone is people, and white folks, get on the stick with this. And I'm going to tell you another thing. Since I'm a teacher, I'm trying to take over your show here. I'm sorry.
Yes.
He's talking about charter schools and the success that they had. And where was it that Obama shut that school that was so successful? If you have not seen the movie documentary Waiting for Superman,
yes,
I highly recommend it. Yes. You watch that movie, it's going to tell you the state of education and exactly what he's talking about. New York is paid, they pay these people to go stand, sit and work and do nothing in a rubber room. That is wrong. And this is why we have kids that can't read, can't write, they're in high school, they're graduating kids, and so it's a mess. But if we don't get out there and be active and speak up and vote for people that are going to do the right thing, not just because they say the right things, we need to know what their ethics are, what their policies are, and we've got to be the ones to do this. And we've got to reach out. Those are some excellent examples to reaching the Hispanic community as well as the Black community.
I was going to say the media is also very
I will translate for you.
Some of the principles of being a conservative.
In Spanish.
Exactly.
I was going to start going to a church and start a group, and maybe even go, Suzanne Blackstone mentioned, just going to what he was saying to the churches and just start speaking
to them. We can't. By the time our alarm clocks go off tomorrow morning, we will not have solved this problem, right? This is a big, monumental, Herculean problem that we're facing. So we have to do it, and someone had a great line today, I'm going to eat the elephant, but I can only do it in little bites, right? I can't eat the whole thing in one sitting. I guess it's less, it's a baby elephant, but, yes, sir.
What states are you targeting for the 2018 election?
I knew somebody would ask me that. So Wisconsin, big target of ours. Tammy Baldwin, yep. She's, I don't care at all that she's gay. She's just a rotten progressive.
Yep.
Let's see. Geez, I'm sorry, I should know this. Wisconsin. I'm sorry, I just. Illinois, no, Indiana, it's coming to me. I'm old, I forget names. I'll get the list to Steve and he can get it to you.
Those states that you're targeting, how do you find the candidates that you want to promote?
We're not. We are. So I'll give you a perfect example. We've gone off script just slightly in one area, and I'm having more fun with this than a four-year-old on Christmas Eve. We just put up, today's Thursday, Tuesday, billboards all over the 43rd Congressional District in Southern California. Anybody want to tell me whose district that is? Maxine Waters, too bad. And you know what the billboard says? It says, I live in a $5 million mansion and there are 66,000 kids living in poverty in my district. And to answer your question, I don't care who runs against him. I want to hurt this gal. I want to make her spend a lot of money to save her seat. And I want to build for the future in that district, because there's now a big Hispanic population in there that I know we can take. And again, if we can show the minorities in that district that she's been lying to them forever and picking their pockets so she can live like a queen and go around running 45. I mean, she truly is one of the dumbest members of Congress. But everybody has the inalienable right to be stupid. Right?
Omar tomorrow will be running again.
Yeah, I know, and I'm not big on him.
You think another person?
Well, I don't know. I understand there's some other candidates in the wing who are thinking about it. But listen, if he's the guy, I'm not going to support him, but I'm going to keep going after Max. And our goal is really not to support a candidate. It's to show the black community, now putting the Max district aside from home, on everything else we're doing, it's to show the minority communities, mostly the black communities, that they've been lied to and that Republicans have their best interest at heart for all the issues that we've talked about tonight.
May I ask a question?
Sure, please.
I'm always puzzled by, you know, the disconnect between the black churches, you know. Did you get a chance to ask these pastors today that I know there are so many good Christians, you know, even black communities, why are they not so strong in pro-life? Because if they are so strong in pro-life, they automatically should support us.
Fred, will you take that one?
Actually, the gentleman on the end was raising his hand.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see you, sir.
Absolutely. How y'all doing? My name is I'm Dr. Dimitri Penny. I'm Sergeant Dimitri Penny, and police officer. Been a Dallas police officer for 18 years. Also have a PhD, doctor from Texas Tech University in higher ed. One of the biggest issues, and I love your question about the church, the black churches. And one of the reasons I go around, I give the same speech all the time, is because the black churches are competing or are trying to keep these same politicians that have manipulated us for years, they're trying to keep those individuals in office. Now, I know I don't want to offend anybody, but I grew up in the black community. I grew up in inner city Houston, Texas, Congressman Sheila Jackson Lee. I grew up there. Listen, I'm gonna tell anybody the truth. I grew up around the whole everything you see with the movements, the marching, the protesting. I grew up with that. I grew up around the New Black Panther Party. So when everything was happening, especially with this wave of Black Lives Matter, I know so many people. It was almost a double negative. It was the black people didn't want to condemn Black Lives Matter. Because it was like they would be considered an uncle Tom. Mm-hmm. White people didn't want to say that something was wrong with Black Lives Matter because they didn't want to be labeled racist. Right. That's what the problem is. Mm-hmm. So for me, I can tell you, as just a lonely police officer, I saw that there was a problem, and I said, I'm going to address this problem. I'm going to try to educate. Hopefully people will listen to me. So I was one of the first individuals. I sued Black Lives Matter. I sued President Barack Obama because he facilitated, he encouraged that after he had lost five officers, he had already validated what that movement was. So I'm saying, I don't care what color you are, I don't care what race, what religion you align with, but I'm saying people, we need to treat people as people. Amen. It doesn't matter what color they are. Now I'm tired of people talking about what happened in the 1960s. We're not living in the 1960s anymore. Times have changed. I understand what history is, but now we're somewhere else. If I'm somebody that can come out of the hood, come out of the inner city, when I tell everybody my story, it's terrible because I didn't have a traditional family. I didn't have a mother, father in the household with me. I didn't have, you know, I came from bad school. But guess what? I have a PhD today. Nobody gave me that. it is the churches. The churches. You got the churches of how they're manipulating the black community. I say it all the time, and I know the president just gave them, you know, say that they what's the deal? They just overturned a lot of churches to politically allow them. There you go. Hey, listen. I'm all for it, but you know what? We got to get into those churches. I guess I'm a conservative now, right? Like, my whole life a Democrat. I don't know. I guess that they told me I'm supposed to be. But listen, I'm saying it's all about, I had to get older. I had to educate myself in order to see how I was being manipulated. The problem, that's the biggest problem in itself, is if we don't know anything else, if we don't know anything outside of our community, we're going to be stuck in that rut forever. And that's how it's been for me. And now I'm seeing something different, and I'm going around and telling the whole world, hey, guys, I see something different.
Project in Connecticut, you know, and then went to school and when I was about to graduate high school, the teachers, the last 6 weeks of school, they're trying to get me ready for college. They didn't do anything prior to 12 years. It was only after after high school, you know, I worked in some jobs and I didn't like the outcomes. And went to a preparatory school and then went to community college. That's why I'm so big on community colleges. And then that's where I graduated from the community college and then went on to a four-year degree of college. You got a scholarship. But what happens in our black community and people like us? And then when I came to Texas, the story is that I came here in 1980, and in my church that I'm in right now, is that it was election time, and they were having a meeting one night talking about who they was going to support. And he said, oh yeah, you know, we got to support the Democrats because they're always there for programs that support us. And I'm labor today because I raised up and I said, hey, I'm a Republican. That really shocked me, so anyway, but the thing it is, what happens is with people like ourselves, is in the party, is that when the public meetings, we don't have the media, and sometimes our own Republican Party don't get people like myself, like this brother, to speak up. They look for other people that are soft cell and that are not committed to conservative principles and values, and that's why they get misled. And in our black churches, and that what happens a lot of times is that our black churches are part of this movement of trying to build and compete with each other. And it's more about them keeping, the pastors keeping their job and not saving anything. And so that's why they soft sell conservatives. They can soft sell the problems that we have in the black community. But we need, you know, what happens is in our black community, you got one little me speaking up, and we don't have enough people, enough variety, enough of you trying to help us. And then the other thing that happens is when people play Republicans as, when they talk bad about y'all, sometimes y'all don't speak up. Most of the time, 90%, you don't defend yourself. Yeah. And you are good. You got a lot of good messages, and you don't do enough of that to speak up about what the Republican Party means and what the party has done in terms of the black community, in terms of our well-being as a people. And so that's why we need some help. It's a great, great message from Dr. Sousa tonight. And but we need things that have, the trend is that even in Crawford County, where the demographics is, it's 42% minority. If you don't start working,
right,
things will change right away. We're on a trend. The trend is bad, 42%. So look out in the next couple, it's coming in the next 2 or 3 years. Things are going to change, and that's why it's such a crisis now. Call it on all of us to do something about it. Thank you.
I was responsible for that lunch that we had today, and it was a great start. I'm telling you, the people were spilling their guts, and they are so full of passion, and they want us there. And we are really missing the boat if we don't deliver. And I'm going to tell you, I taught in not an inner city school, but I taught at Richardson High School, where 60 different languages were spoken at home. But we had the link club that linked all the cultures. shoulders together. It can be done. We just have to have the passion and the guts to show up. How many of you know that the Republican Party in Texas was founded by black people? Well, maybe we need to educate ourselves too, huh? And I'm a teacher, so follow me. But seriously, I'm planning on doing a lot of things, lots of baby steps, and I will be coming to all the different clubs asking for people to show up. I hope you will. I'm going to try and make things fun. We need to show up at Cinco de Mayo. We need to show up at Martin Luther King Day. We need to show up where the people are. And we can make it fun. A sea of red helium-filled balloons blanketing the place. Oh my God, the Republicans are here! And we will auction off or raffle off a TV, a Keurig, or something. And you can't get it unless you give us your name, your mailing address, your email, your phone number. And now we have a mailing list. So, we can do this.
And a data entry person.
Yeah, well, that's not me, so. But somebody will be willing to do that. And we've got to involve our young people. I know Dalton has a young guy, young son, who's homeschooled. There are a lot of homeschoolers who are ready and willing to help us out. So, all we got to do is step up.
Very conservative Republican as well. So, but you know, it seems as though, and I appreciate what you said about going into the community in terms of getting 4 or 5% of the vote in order to win elections. And I also appreciate what you said about it's a long-term thing, right? It's baby steps and so on. But it seems as though it's so surface level in terms of what we're trying to do in terms of getting the votes. One of my questions is, are we falling short in terms of getting the minority population, whether it's blacks, Asian Americans, Hispanics, be more involved in the political spectrum? Because quite honestly, and I looked at the survey, again, no offense to the people that are running for various city council seats, whatever, there's not a whole lot of diversity going for those seats. And I would imagine that would cover what's going on the outside as well. So if it truly is true that 40% of the population in Collin County is minority descent, then why is it that we don't have 40% of those diverse candidates that are running for some of these seats? So it just seems like we're falling short in terms of really recruiting minority candidates to some of these chair seats, whatever. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
You can't recruit the minority folks to run if you don't know who the hell they are. And the only way you're gonna know who they are is by going into the community and talking to them. And you'll run into someone, they'll say, you know, I've always thought about running for whatever. Really? Tell me more about it. Tell me what your dreams and your goals are. Tell me what you want to accomplish. Tell me why you want to do it. Let me come to our meeting the second Thursday and let me introduce you to a whole bunch of Republicans who would adore you. And I don't care if it's the only black person in the room or the only Hispanic or the only whatever. It's a start. It's baby step. I agree with you. We need more minority candidates to be running with an R next to their name. But the only way that's going to happen is by getting to know who these folks are and talking to them.
That's why Dimitri is running for office.
I wanted to stand in front of you for a minute and talk about this. I introduced myself a minute ago, but you may not have picked up who I am. I am the chairman of the Collin County Republican Party. And I don't necessarily share your concern about the Republican Party, but what I do share is the fact that historically we have not been engaged consistently in talking to our neighbors. And when I became chairman, I made a commitment that no precinct in Collin County would go untouched with a conservative message. But let me tell you something, folks. we are engaged in a long-term effort. We've got to get out of the every other year mentality where we just look at candidates and recognize that if we're going to do the kind of education, if we're going to do the kind of outreach, if we're going to have the kinds of conversations with people one-on-one and in small groups that we have to have, that we have to have an organization that's consistent and that has the money, has the resources, has the leadership, has the people to do it day in and day out. Now, I will commit to you that if any of you in any community want to get together and introduce me to people in that community, I'll be there. Let me give you a personal experience. When I came to Texas in 1974, I came as a Woodrow Wilson Foundation intern, and I was assigned to Bishop College, a predominantly black college in South Dallas, where I worked for 3 years as one of the only three whites in the administration. And I've got to tell you something, and it's the same thing that Terry said. Terry's hiding somewhere.
Yeah,
It's the same thing that Terry said. It's the same thing that Lily said. It's the same thing that you said. And that is, every person in that college was a conservative at heart. They all wanted a good education. They all wanted opportunity. They all respected individual responsibility. They respected good police. They respected safe streets. They respected honoring the family. They are conservatives. The reason they don't vote conservative is that, quite frankly, if we are not there delivering the message one-on-one and in small groups, and yes, through the media, but the media is not the only one, and actually it's not even the best one. Maybe for short term, but not for long term. We have to learn how to be friends. And everyone in this room can do this. Every one of you has influence. Every one of you knows people. How many times, even in the last week, if you reached out to anybody to invite them into your world of conservatism as to why you're a conservative? And forget for a moment being a Republican. Obviously, I'm the Republican chairman. But we're sitting here among Tea Party people. We're sitting here among citizens. Citizens. We care about our country. We care about our future. But the way we're going to achieve this is all together. And so, Maggie, thank you for putting this together. And Terry, I know that Terry's working on a committee. We're not ready to roll it out. But quite frankly, it's a committee to even to begin to identify all the different events in Collin County we should be at. Because you got to know them first before you can get there. And then we've got to find the people to man them and whatever. So we're starting that process of nothing else, just finding out where we need to be and when we need to be there. But I will commit to you my time, and I have committed my resources to doing this job. I know everyone in this room has done the same thing, but let's remember we've got to do it together for it to work, for it to be effective, and for it to be long-term, people. We've got to get out of this idea that it's just the candidate. It's not just the candidate. It's principles. It's principles. So anyway, I'm thank you. Thank you for giving me my time.
I want to ask you about what's happening with the Democratic Party.
Yep.
That's growing, that they're coming in here, going to the campaigns as well, and I see that they're going to start attacking our areas here.
Yep.
And it's purchased 40%. So how do you fight that? How do you?
Exactly what we've been talking about all night. Get out and meet with the folks. Learn who they are. Tell them about our conservative principles. They're believers. They just haven't been told yet. It's, don't worry about what the opposition thinks. It doesn't matter. It is meaningless. Do what we need to do, and we win. When we ran the radio ads in North Carolina and Louisiana, we didn't care one iota what the Democrat was doing. That wasn't part of our strategy. It's what do we need to do to bring the blacks out to vote for the Republican? And the same thing is true here. I know that Texas has a big bullseye on it by the progressives. And unless we start reaching out, because folks, if you look at the statistics around the country, all us white people, we're getting old.
Yes.
Right? We ain't gonna be around forever. And who's gonna replace us, right? If you've got kids in college, they're getting indoctrinated every single day by the left. So what we've got to do is go to our natural base. It's the minorities. I know that sounds kind of silly, but it's not. It's factual. They believe the same way we do. We just haven't communicated with each other yet.
Something they are showing though. Today they went to a school that has a lot of minorities that has a bad reputation because of that, and a lot of the city officials that are here actually attended. So
that is absolutely sensational.
Yes.
And I hope that follow up letters and follow up emails and follow up whatever goes out to all those kids in the school saying, gee, it was great meeting you, and you know, this is not a one-time fixes-all thing. This is a campaign to get into the communities, to reach out to the folks, to talk to them, to get to understand them, what their issues are. 45-minute meeting is great, but that's just the beginning, just the very beginning. Yes, sir.
Yes, I have a question about reaching out. Is this on?
Yeah. Yep.
Reaching out to the Muslim communities and first, let me preface it with what happened here in Plano, Texas. And that was after 9/11. The people in the mosque there on Independence kind of reached out. And the message was, we are Americans. We love our country. Our boys fight in the armed services. And they were reaching out. But then, at some point, I guess with the rise of ISIS and with the influence of the Muslim Brotherhood under Obama, the Muslim community here pulled back, seemed to be isolated. And I'm wondering if you've had experience in trying to reach out to social conservatives.
You know, I haven't. And how do I say this? I don't give a damn about reaching out to the Muslim community. The vast majority of Muslims who've come to this country don't want to be Americans. They want us to abide by their traditions and what they want and so. And I'm painting with a really broad brush here, and shame on me. But it's been my experience. So believe me, when I see Muslim immigrants who don't want to throw down the prayer mat right in the middle of the street, and who don't want Sharia law in the United States, I'll be the first one to reach out to them. But until that happens, I got a big enough job with the other minorities. Okay, and you know, you can throw rotten tomatoes at me if you wish. If you have them, please feel free to throw them. But between the Black community and the Hispanic community and the Asian community, we got our hands full. And I think trying to convert Muslims today, I think, is a really, really heavy lift when we've got other jobs to do.
I'm so glad that you're here.
Thank you. So am I.
Our dear beloved Dr. Carson had a 3-footed stool he used throughout his campaign, and it was heal, inspire, revive. And I think we need to remind ourselves of this. Many of us in here worked on the campaign. I see many familiar faces. I was the regional chairman for the DFW region, and I've met with many of you throughout his campaign. And we did something real simple. We went everywhere, just like you're identifying, the festivals, the flea markets, not necessarily the churches, but the church festivals. What happens after, in the fall we have the church, but what happens after the first of the year? So I'm tasking all of you, if you know a festival, if you know any place that's gonna have a big gathering where you can have a booth, you take those Republican papers with you and you just talk your way through all the people. And if you don't speak Spanish, you, like I said, take a translator with you. And the other thing I took away today from our meeting was, while we all share, black, white, brown, yellow, whatever, we're all citizens, we're all friends. I don't believe in this folks here and folks there. We're all folks. But the thing I took away today was, while we all share the conservative values, there's some of us who don't give a flip about the tax reform. There's a lot of poor people. And while they are principled people, have integrity, they also have other needs. So we gotta listen better. And that was one thing I took away. Rex, remember today we talked about the 50% of Americans, you know? So anyway, you just really inspired us, and I thank you.
Oh, very, very, very kind of you. Thank you. Thank you.